Bum-ba-da-bum. Hey, this is Sean. What's going on? More lights. Aziz. Da-da-da, da-da-da. Yay. Anyway, what are we doing here? We are looking at the nerdarchy guys. They're going to talk about railroading. Railroading is the most amazing invention for D&D players. It's the only way you can play D&D. Modules and crap. So they're going to say how to do it the right way. Apparently, everyone's doing railroading the wrong way. What difference? 40 years later, what difference does it make? I'm against railroading, but a lot of my subscribers are hella love with railroading. They love it. They love it so much. They just keep coming back to watch my stuff. So I thought, hey, let's do some more pro railroading videos. Oh my gosh. These guys are the fountain, the founts of knowledge here.
Railroading is such a dirty word in D&D. Why?
Maybe if you do it wrong, let's discuss how to railroad your.
Oh god, my God. Okay, are they reading something? That's role play some average people.
Your D&D players properly.
I'm Nerdarchus Ted.
And I'm Nerdarchus Dave. Welcome to Nerdarchy for nerds by nerds.
Time to hop aboard this one-way train.
Okay, well that counts me out then. This is for nerds. I'm not their target audience.
All right, let's start off with what is railroading?
So railroading is a metaphorical term that describes a game.
Stop reading, you fuck. Just say what it is. We're in the hobby forever and we still can't explain railroading, but we have a wiki article. Wiki fandom.
Game master style in which player characters are forced by lack of options or through narrative to accept seemingly by.
Key word is narrative, through narrative. Let's see if they mention the narrative part. Oh, we don't narrate. We're against the narrative part.
Fiat actions that affect the character.
So, in a role-playing game, I find players are very unhappy when they don't feel like they have many choices. And that's where railroad.
Okay, your players are unhappy? Why are you fucking doing that to your players, for one? In this day and age, why are you pissing off your players?
Roading gets a bad rap.
Absolutely. And we've had many discussions about railroading over the course of our long gaming career.
Of
And
course you have.
when you take away that choice, it feels like you're like removing a limb from the players, like.
By the way, every one of their live streams or actual plays is a railroad. It's a fucking railroad. The DM is this Disneyland storyteller. And the players just sit there. They sit there the whole time waiting to be asked to roll dice. The only participation the players have in the game is when they roll dice because they're asked to.
Not just their characters. They feel attacked when they can't make those decisions.
Yeah, so you have to work in these things into the narrative in a way that makes the players feel.
I mean, if you think about it, they say nerds don't have social skills. They don't have very good communication skills. And someone who's not familiar with nerds will who if they accidentally ask, why is that? Why don't they have social skills? Like who would care what a nerd thinks? But if they were curious, they would go and watch a D&D game. There's your answer.
Feel like they have choices, they have options, their options matter.
So in other words, you have to describe it appropriately.
You do have to describe it appropriate, Ted. That was terrible. Folks, the reason why that's so terrible is we're going to tell you about something that's not terrible, and that is describe, right? Describe is finely crafted box text, right? it is a company that is sponsoring this video.
Oh, fuck you. Fuck you. Let's see. How long is their fucking intro? Why is railroading bad? Okay, here we go.
Players want, I mean, we've kind of said this already. The players want to feel like they're making choices and their choices matter. So also, there's a way that you, that GMs will railroad their players where they like trick them into not having.
Okay, now they're not on script. See, this is when they tend to fuck up because they can't lip sync or lip read or nothing when they need to.
Having a choice, which really makes it worse. And I want to really get into and dive into how to get around that and make it more palatable for the players. But like, that's the worst thing you can do as the GM is trying to trick them into doing the.
My players don't like being railroaded. You're not doing railroading right. Instead of listening to the players, you just double down on your railroading.
Things that you want them to do, and them feeling like they never had a real choice in the matter.
All right.
What is this? Oh, fuck. Anime sucks.
How can we railroad in a good way and leave all that negativity behind?
First of all, when you are going to have something happen to the players, just do it. Don't try to trick them into trying to make the decisions that you want them to make. Instead, if you want them to be on a boat,
just take away their player agency. Be like most DMs and just all of a sudden the players are over here now where you need them to be.
Oh, in the beginning of your campaign, let them know this is how the campaign starts. They are just on the boat. There's no hoops to jump through. There's no you trying to convince them to get on the boat. No, they're just on the boat.
You know, we've used, you know, quite a lot of different styles over the years. And like, there are times where like I look back on, you know, my DM moments where I've done this kind of stuff.
You still role play the way you did when you were 14. What are you trying to say here?
You know, with shame, where I felt like I've had to trick the players or tell them, no, straight up, this is where the adventure's going. I need you to do X. But because there were those, I'm giving you choice, I'm giving you agency, players felt like, oh, well, I can do this. And if you do, oh, well, sorry, you know, you're out of the adventure. Sorry, toodaloo. So it can be very problematic. But, you know, every time you sit behind a GM's...
I don't want to be in your railroad game. I'm leaving. Oh no, I'm going to post a video on YouTube on why my players are leaving my game. What am I doing wrong in my game?
Screen. Every time you play a role-playing game, you've got the capabilities to learn and grow as a player and as a GM.
Now, when they say role-playing game, they're really saying TTRPG. TTRPG is it's just an acronym for a retard gaming group at the tabletop. I don't know why. Tabletop is one word. Why do they have two T's? Anyway, so the players get to be told a Disneyland story from the Disneyland storyteller. The players want to be told how amazing their characters are. There's no role play. There's no role play in these TTRPG games. That's why they're called TTRPGs. You don't role play in those things. You move a pog around on the screen, or you move a mini semi-painted or crap-painted mini on the table. Actually, the DM moves them for you because you don't know how to move anything. Because you're a nerd. You're a fucking nerd. You can't even read maps. And here you are using a game that has maps.
Just remember, every day there's things happening to people that they wouldn't have chosen to happen to them, right? They're the victim of circumstance. So if you want to railroad your players in a way that is going to receive less friction, you have to do it in that way. You have to have circumstances happen where it was beyond their control, because that's just normal. That's just life. It'll happen in a role-playing game, and it happens in real life, you know. And then from there, that's when you have to open it up and let go, and they do whatever they want to do. Like, me and Doug were talking, and...
Yeah, they get to sandbox around on the boat, or they get to sandbox around in room 11 in the dungeon. They're still on a railroad. Don't they have to go somewhere? Don't the players have to be somewhere? You're running a fucking campaign. The campaign's been preordained, as it were. It's a fucking long-ass story. The players are going through the story. Sounds like a railroad to me.
A lot of his adventures start on a boat going to the place where the adventures are going to happen. And it's very sandboxy once they get off the boat. But before they get on, before that, it is not. This is how the adventure starts. We start on the boat.
Oh my God, you're still talking about the boat. Move on, people. Next. They don't have anything to say. If these guys don't fucking have a script to read or a game module to read to the players, they're clueless. They're clueless. They have no comprehension skills on explaining something original. Describing a scene, a setting for the players. No. They have no clue. It's like rubbing IQs together and still ending up with double digits.
It gives the players a chance to interact with each other, the role play, they explore the boat, explore the NPCs, get to know the NPCs, and do these things, but they're in this confined space. And, you know, aside from jumping overboard, which is a role playing game, you could technically do that and you may drown, but it is an option. But, you know, aside from that, you know, that's where the game started. And I find players are going to be okay if you're like...
The game started or the narration started? Do the players ever say what they're doing on the boat? Has that ever happened in any of your games? Have the players ever opened their mouth while they're on the boat? Are they even paying attention to the game? Or they just want to be told what happens next in the story?
Oh, you know, this is kind of the concept for the game, and you tell them up front. But if you like try and trick them into getting on the boat or persuade them to get on the boat, you're going to make your life so much more difficult as the dungeon master, and also for the players as well. It's so much easier for...
Okay, let's say you don't start on the boat, and it's frustrating that you're trying to get your players on the boat. Why is that frustrating? Is it because you're trying to railroad your players? I mean, in your mind, you're probably thinking, well, the game won't start until they get on the boat. Technically, the story doesn't start till they get on the boat. Technically, the campaign doesn't start until they get on the boat. Now, you could have a social contract where it clearly states what your motives are. So the players aren't, you know, so the players could choose not to be in your game.
For a lot of this stuff, if you just tell them what you want, you know, what you want from them, and then they can like agree or not agree, you know, depending on whether they want to be in your game or not.
You've already, okay, these guys talk in a loop. My God, is this the third time now they've mentioned something about players not wanting to be in their games?
Right, but it's so much better than just trying to force them or trick them.
You know, if you look at...
Yeah, if you force or trick them, they might not be in your game. Okay, say something next. Say something else on this video.
At, you know, the concept as a from a Dungeon Master perspective, I'm going to tell my players, we are starting on a boat. Well...
Yeah, we got that. We got that. Yeah. Understood. And what's the very next thing? How do they get off the boat? How do you guys accomplish that task without railroading the players? Because you basically told the players, hey, I'm going to be running this module. I just need you to show up to, you know, I'm running the game solo. I need your help, guys. It's boring playing D&D solo. Can you just be in the game for once and roll dice for me? Just be random number generators for me, so I'm not rolling all the dice and playing this game by myself.
That means as a player character, I should not come to the table with hydrophobia and I'm afraid of boats and the water and what.
Okay. What is going on here, Ted? Ted. Are you dealing with people with special needs in your game? What is going on here? Do your players have handlers, Ted?
What have you? Because my character concept's not going to work with the way the campaign is going to start. You know, when you look at some of the aspects of, you know, the characters in Critical Role, you know, the second campaign.
Okay, don't compare yourselves to Critical Role. They're entertaining. They're entertaining the troops. They're not role-playing. They're not really playing a game. Unless it's combat, they're not really playing a game. They're not... Okay. Critical Role and one other channel on YouTube, there's only two, are doing something completely different than what you guys are doing at your table.
There's a character who has that, and that has to be confronted before they can get on the boat. So if you're going to start the campaign and you're going to instantly go to a player's, you know, our player character's fears, that can slow everything down because now we're, you know, tailoring everything to this one particular character. So it is.
Yeah, you get the player who wants to basket weave. It's like, okay, what does this have to do with anything? No, the player just has this funny, kooky idea that his character is going to be doing basket weaving, and he needs to find the materials to make baskets while he's on the boat. It's like, why do you have that person in your game? There's always that person, though. Always in these games.
It's very important to talk and communicate with your players, with your, you know, with your dungeon master, as to where everything is going to go, so that you can get into the narration. You can get into what the
just tell the players you want to read them a story. Just the social contract is that I'm gonna read you guys a story, okay? Can you just let me read you a story, please? These are romper room dungeon masters with a bunch of preschool kids. And they want to read the... While the kids are taking their nappies on their blankies, the romper room teachers want to read them a little story.
The story is to start.
Yeah, you know, a good example of this would be an example of it being done poorly, right? Was like Ted had this great idea for a campaign, and he wanted to run this pre-made campaign called Ghost Walk, and the idea is you're dead. The characters die, and that's when the adventure starts.
That sounds cool. So what was his problem? He can't run a game? He can't successfully run a game that's remotely interesting?
He's like, but your idea was like, how much cooler would it be if I kill them and then have it start that way? Your players are not going to appreciate that. Now, yeah. If instead you go to your players and go, hey.
Okay, well, what's the tone? What's the themes, the settings, the moods? You got to find out from your players. Are the players even remotely interested in that? You know, the game starts with all the players being ceremoniously executioned. You know, they're just firing squad. They're all shot to death. Blindfolded. They all got cigarettes in their mouth, you know, that kind of thing. And each one gets shot in the heart. Boom, boom, boom. Would the players be okay with their characters having that happen to them? They don't even get to see anything. They're already blindfolded. They're already being shot at. Or the characters are in some sort of a deathmatch arena. They're running, they have to run across a field, and it's got mind, it's a minefield they have to run across. One by one, they're getting blown up. Or they're in a city. And no matter where they go, the nuke is going to get them. The big bad nuke. So they're vaporized. No matter where they seem to go in the city, they die. Who knows? It could be a reoccurring dream that each one has independently. It's been going on for a month now. They wake up after dying in a nuke attack. Except one time, they stay dead. They don't wake up. You know, it depends on... Before you start a game, you want to talk to your, you know, talk to your players and get an idea, a guesstimation of what's interesting for everyone at the table to run. Has to be interesting for the person running the game. Has to be interesting for the players. Has to have role play in there. It has to be something interesting to role play for the characters. The problem with D&D is its campaign. It could go on for years. You're wasting your life playing D&D if the campaign just sucks from the beginning. That's why I don't do campaigns.
We're going to do this campaign, but it starts when you die. I'm going to need you.
It's like, why do they even say campaign? It's like a default, right? You don't have to say, you know, crazy guy like Santa here, you don't have to say campaign. It's the default. Obviously, it's a fucking campaign.
You guys to tell me how your character died, right?
Xbox. Were they showing Starfield? What happened to Starfield? What a mess that is. And then the creation kit, you have to wait for that to come out before you can start fixing the game.
Then they're on board because you gave them agency, you gave them choice. So that makes the players happy, and you're happy because as the dungeon master, you get to run the game you wanted to run. I've done something similar.
Run the game you wanted to run. Screw the players. I'm going to run the game I want to run. That's the spirit.
I ran a one-shot adventure I call Valhalla Awaits, and the premise...
Okay, I'm still... How do you do the railroading right, though? How is it done right? Why is it done at all? But they're trying to do it right? I guess if you don't do it right, then your players leave your game? I think the players... Most players suffer from Stockholm Syndrome. They're going to hang around. Thank you. Can I have another?
This is... Your group of warriors that once they you want to get into Valhalla, but you're on the edge as to whether they're going to let you in or not. So you have to go through some final tests or trials, and you know. So it starts off with the players describing.
Oh no! All the players have to get to Valhalla, so they all have to pass their stupid little tests. And if one of them doesn't pass, oh my God, we can't continue the story. Don't do the tests. Or make them all do the same test together. They either all fail together or they all make it through together. If they don't pass the test together as a collective, they'll still get to Valhalla. They just have to go the hard way. They gotta use the rear door exit and entrance. They have to go through the back orifice to get in.
How they died in battle. And if they want to, they can also tell me and the other players, you know, what's keeping them out of Valhalla. And then we start the adventure.
Yeah, I love this. And at some point in time, I want to get in on the Valhalla 08's game because it's a blast. I absolutely hate sharing the Ghostwalk story because it's so embarrassing that like every aspect of how I railroaded that was just bad. But as I said earlier, Every time you play, you've got, you know, those aha, those learning moments. You know, so what can we do to...
Let the players roleplay. Roleplay solves everything. But again, D&D is not a role-playing game, so... Oh, if only it was, though. You know, if only D&D, you know, out of the box was a role-playing game instead of it being retconned years later as being a role-playing game. The first role-playing game. It wasn't a role-playing game. Now all of a sudden it's the first role-playing game ever, you know. Who rewrote history?
To improve. And, you know, I look at these things of when you give the players and their characters agency with it, as Dave brought.
Can you say it, Ted? Can you say the word role play? Fucking role. These people say they role play. They play role playing games. Yet there's no role play in their role playing games. And then people get upset with me because I mention role play. How come people don't role play in their role playing games? People get so upset about that. It's like, you know, lifting a rock and you see all the bugs underneath a rock. That's most people. Most people. I'm just exposing it is all. Exposing the lowlifes to the sun.
Brought up. You know, I ran, you know, my second full-length campaign in 5e. I you know, everybody decided we were going to do a 12-session story arc, which was definitely outside the realm of something that I had done previously. Most of my games were very open-ended.
Outside the realm? You weren't playing on Earth? You weren't playing in the garage again? What? Explain this realm, this other realm you were in.
And the last one that I ran for like over 4 years from the course of levels, you know, 1 to 20. Sort of to be confined to, I only have 12 sessions, you know, basically 36 hours of game time to tell an entire story. I was seriously flummoxed, you know, but we all sat down and, you know, we did our session zero and the players got to create how they interacted with each other, what their backstories were, how they linked.
Yeah. Okay, so session zero, the players got to do something other than roll dice. What happened in session one? What changed? Everyone's like pumped. They're psyched for this campaign. Then session one begins, and it's like, you know, the whole vibe is lost. The magic is lost. It's now formulae. Players are basically formulae.
Who the villain was, and I took everything from there. So everyone was already connected, already vested in this villain, and then because it was a 12-session arc, I had that villain make an appearance at 4, 8, and then at 12 to, you know, kind of end, you know, this story. And from my perspective, I didn't feel that there was choice. I felt that it was like a very heavy, here is a railroaded campaign. But every time I've talked about it, you know, Dave is like, no, everything that happened was all based off of the choices that we made as characters. We wanted this dude dead, so we were going to keep hunting him down.
Yeah, so the best way.
Yeah, the players want to stay in the game. They want to hear the ending. They want to hear how the story ends. Yeah, they had agency. Players had agency.
To railroad your players is get them to railroad themselves into your adventure, right? And that's gonna go a long way. And you know,
nothing about sandboxing or railroading or I got this cool setting, you guys want to be in it, make some characters, there's a bad guy in the setting, do what you want, however you want. Just stay in characters, all please, for once. D&D players are never in character. Never. Doesn't matter what their character is. They're going to go into the dungeon and play Scooby-Doo. They're going to go into the dungeon and everyone's a freaking psychopathic killer.
When you have an outcome that you seek as the dungeon master, the easiest way to get there is to also want the players to want the same thing, right? And that's, you know, that can be the tricky part in figuring that out. But, you know, in that campaign, it worked out perfectly. Session zero really set the tone. And from there on out, you know, we
Session Zero sets the tone for Session Zero. I've seen it. Session Zero is kind of... That's where players ask questions. Because they're making characters. They want to make sure their characters match the setting that you're going to be running. You know, the characters need to know, or do they need to know, the setting. Maybe the characters discover the setting as they explore via sandbox in the setting. Or do the characters already know this place? And they know everyone. They know the lore. Now notice I'm saying character, I'm not saying player. I don't give a shit what the players think. Because you're role-playing a character. Why would you be role-playing yourself in a game? You're role-playing a character. The only thing the player does is roll dice. The character does everything else. Right. Now, if a player is not role-playing, what's left for the player to do? Roll dice? Roll dice only? Maybe ask a bunch of Mother May I questions? Because they failed Session Zero?
We were able to play the story arc that Ted had planned because we had already been bought into it in Session Zero.
So when you look at these kinds of things, that player buy-in is super critical. You know, the storylines that you want to tell.
Super critical. I'm in a J. Scott Garibay. Bless his little heart. He used to be in your games. He used to run games for you guys. What happened? Did you guys leave him or did he leave you?
They need to connect. If you have the slightest bit of hesitation, you know, from the players, they're not all in. And when they're not all in, you know, that is when they're going to buck. That's when there's going to be, you know, an issue with the rails.
That's when the train is going to derail, Ted. Is that what you're trying to tell me?
That's when the train is going to derail. They're going to want to get off. They're going to want to go in another direction, or they're going to buck against you as the DM because they don't want to go to the story that you're trying to tell. You know, so you have to look at all of these things. You have to, you know, you have to get everyone on board.
Well, Ted, I think we gave some pretty good DM advice today, but hey, if you want some things to avoid, check out Worst Ways to DM. It's around here somewhere. Just click.
And if you want to help us keep making videos like this...
You don't need help. You've been making these videos forever. You obviously don't need help making them.